This is Rento Combining with Mike. Status, July 2020. So, welcome to this month's status. I'm a little late. I normally would try to do this video like in one of the final days of the month or the first day of the next month. However, I was to my little brother's wedding this weekend, so I prioritized that I could do this video when I got back. Cheers. And I got a greeting from Geek with Social Skills from USA. And I gotta say right away, I'm sorry if the sound is a little bit weird today. Normally I use a headset, but we use that headset for doing lectures at a great hacker festival in Denmark. I can try giving it a little bit more volume. Is that better? So my standard headset is, out being used for a festival, which I'm going to attend myself as well later this week. So I'm trying to use this microphone instead. Great. I am open for questions. So ask questions in the chat or in the Discord server. Oh, I forgot to open the Discord. Sorry. Give me just a second. Great. I am now on Discord myself. However, I will try to save the answering of the questions for the end of the stream. Great. What have been doing? So, first project, which I have not made a video about, is that I make what I decided to call flags for when I'm mirroring ancient floppies. This is a bunch of floppies I borrowed from a guy named Thomas for my old Comet 8, which is a very rare CPM machine. I want to preserve the pictures of the floppies together with the content of the floppies. So I made like this. It's just a laminated piece of paper with a pre-printed form. And then I write on it with a whiteboard pen. So I should be able to... okay, it's dried in now. With a little bit of alcohol, I can clean this off and use it for the next project. And then I made a lot of small numbers, which I will lay next to the floppy when I take a picture of it. And then when I make the image of the floppy, I will use the same number. So D7, or I can use an example from the ones I got here. So this floppy is named A5. And I got... Maybe I should do it like that. And I got pictures of the floppy stored together with the images of the floppy, so that I will be able to remember which physical media contains the data. And that took some time, but I have to return those discs to the owner in a very short while, so I had to get it done in this month. And I haven't made a video about it because, well, I probably will make a video about it, but I'm kind of not there yet. Great. I also spent quite a lot of time improving the studio. I had to upgrade my file server. I made a video about that. I ran out of space. Like, I spent 4 times 2 terabyte in just under a year. I had hoped that I could wait with this upgrade until I could afford a really, really great server. But that's not the thing. So I decided to upgrade the hard drives in this one. So now I got 4 times 4 terabyte. And there's a video about that. And I got a question about what I'm drinking. I'm drinking a cheap Danish knockoff Coke Zero. Focus, goddammit. No? There we go. So this is just a Coke Zero, sugar-free Coke for people with low income, I guess. Cheers. Oh. Okay. So I made some upgrades to my studio. One of the most awesome things is the... this is my podium where I normally do my videos. But I installed Cheers to People with Low Income, yeah. I decided to install a background, photo background. You see the white roll up there. And to do that, I had to extend the shelf like a meter. So you see the top section of it, that part is new. And then we bolted on this part onto it. And it works very, very well. I also added, you see this piece of metal here is actually normally used for hanging up posters. But it works perfect to keep the background here straight as well. This took about a day to mount this. And then we had a corner of the studio, which we couldn't use for anything because it was cornered by two shelves. So we decided to mount the studio gear in there so we could utilize that space. So if you see, this is a studio light. This is another studio light. This is a softbox. I'm still waiting for the second softbox, which is supposed to stand over here. But the shop promised me that they would have it in like a week. That's almost a month ago now, and I still haven't gotten my softbox. And then I got a couple of light stands down here. This is an ordinary boom stand. And this is, as far as I remember, no, this is a boom stand. Ordinary, this is a boom stand with wheels on. And this is just a normal stand with wheels on. So I have added a whole new feature to my studio without the need of really using that much space. That was an awesome hack, I think. But it took me a lot of time, which I could not make any kind of videos about. So yeah, I felt like I was set a little bit back by that. And I haven't even used it yet because my the last softbox hasn't arrived yet. That's a little bit of a shame, but I'll probably get back to that. Then I upgraded my computer. I have been editing for a little while ago on a Mac Mini, which got way too slow. Then I changed to Windows on i5, which was 5 years old. And I actually liked that Adobe Premiere on Windows. So I decided to spend the money on an AMD Ryzen 9 3900X 12 core. That's a huge improvement. It will render a movie that normally would take me 20 minutes in just about 3 minutes. I think 3 minutes and 15 seconds for my storage server video. That's a nice processor. It was pretty expensive, and so was the photo gear. So I had to sell some stuff. I had an IBM. Let me just get back to this one. I had an IBM 1560, and I had an old tripod I wasn't using, but it was a kind of nice Manfrotto tripod. So I got kind of a nice portion of money for that. And using those money, I could pay almost all of the background gear and the new computer. I had to spend a little money myself, but I made some extra money doing some consulting work, so I could afford it. It cost me about 5,000 Danish kroners, which is about 800-900 euros for a new motherboard and the Ryzen CPU. But that's a huge improvement, because now when I have shot a video and rendered and ready to upload it, and I discover a small mistake. Back in the old days, I wouldn't fix it because it would take me like 30 minutes to do so. Now I can fix it in maybe 5 minutes. So I already used that a couple of times where I made a small mistake. So that's already improved my content a lot. Yeah. Oh yeah, and a final small project I made. I have a lot of storage around here. And this is a picture of one of my shelvings before I made this upgrade. So I got a couple of boxes here, and you see all the boxes have lids on them. The problem is that if I want to enter this one, I think this is, that's the box I have with serial cables. If I want to enter that, I first have to take this one down and take out the lid of this one, and then I can get to my cables. That's an even huge, larger problem when I'm tidying up and I need to put a cable back. I need to take this one down, open this one, put the cable in, close the lid, put this one back. Then I go keep on with my tidying up, and I find another cable that has to go in this box. So I decided to add some more what is that called? Shelvings? Oh no, the whole thing is called a rack, and this is just a shelf. So I added extra shelf so that the boxes would stand on its own shelf, and then I added a small, changed them out for smaller boxes without a lid on. And then I used the top of the racks to store a lot of boxes with projects in them. So this is projects I'm not going to, this is boxes I'm not going to take down that often. So like this is a project with a DMMC I'm using. This is a project with my Lambda 3800. This is more this is the serial boxes you saw on the first picture. So that was a bad example because that one is up there. But that's because I'm not using that box this often. For instance, you see here, I got my protective gear, glasses and gloves. I got my Dremel down there. I got my screws and I got my fittings and I have batteries and labels. So things I'm using often has been put into boxes that are easy to get to. And it already helped me a lot. So I like that little hack as well. And yeah, Jacob just arrived, and actually Jacob was the one who forgot to give me the microphone for this stream. So, but I talked to him later earlier yesterday, and I said that I would try to get this one to work instead, and it appears to be working. Cheers. So. Videos of this month is the next on my point. Oh, that's not videos of the month. That's me. Okay. I had prepared that tab, but apparently I screwed it up. So if we see here, status for June counts as a video for July because I released it in July. Not much to say there. Then I made the video about my FreeNAS upgrade project. It was an interesting video to make because I made a project that spent several days. So I had to film something, do something else, get back to it, change a little. I had to change the hard drive. Wait 6 hours, change it again, wait 6 hours, change it again. And in the middle of this process, I had to go out of town for a day and a half. So it took quite a lot of time. It was interesting to try that. I would have liked to make stop motion of it, but a server which resolves a hard disk array is not interesting to look at. So the stop motion, no, not the stop motion. What is it called? Fast forward. What is that called when you do like you take a picture each second and play them back fast? Okay, well, it's not interesting now because I'm not gonna do it. I might do it when I work something with chemicals or something in the future. Anyway, then we made this video, which I hinted in the last status about where we built a P11. Actually, that was also done together with Jakob, who is on the chat right now. I'm not sure how many visitors we have. Five? Oh, interesting. So welcome, everybody. Anyway, that was me and Jacob, or Blackthorn, as he prefers to be called. We made this video about a PDP 11, which is a replica of the PDP 11. And Jacob built it, or Blackthorn built it, and then we played Star Trek on it and died because I suck at gaming. So that's going to be a part two of that one. I need to practice my Star Trek skills, and he wants to improve the machine a bit. So stay tuned for that. Then I purchased an Amstrad NC100 from a guy who apparently didn't care because he just wrapped it in a plastic bag and shipped it. The machine took some damage, but I managed to glue it back together. However, the machine came with a 1 megabyte memory card. And that was actually the part I wanted to get my hands on, because I have a lot of NC100s already. I just didn't have a memory card. So I made a small video about that where I tested it and it works. And I got a cool project in place for to use that machine for. So, but that's not going to be in the next month at least. And I'm going to say more about that later. Sean just says he really dislikes it when setters don't package vintage hardware properly. Tell me about it. I tried it so many times. It's really... I have an old Sharp machine right over there, which I need to glue together. Once I got an Apple IIc monitor, which had been dropped. It just sucks. My Yashica MSX computer, YC64, also had to be glued back together. I was lucky with that one, though, because that actually turned out pretty nice. I got a video about that in my channel. So AJ says, that's a greetings from Sweden. And he asks if I'm in Copenhagen. And that's correct. Yeah, I'm in Copenhagen. Welcome to the stream. Then I made this video is titled, I'm right. No, it's not. It's titled Made in Denmark. That's a talk I gave at the Danish Hacker Festival, the camp. And it's about the book I'm writing. I'm going to write a book about old Danish computers. Sean just writes the monitors need at least 4 inches of packaging and double boxed. I agree, if not more than that. Cheers. Oh, it's hard to keep track on what I have to say and the chat, but I try. Forgive me if it's not working that well. Anyway, I'm working on this book about some Danish computers, and I got started on this because I wanted to go to the library and borrow books about this line of computers, and there wasn't any. So I looked around, and it seems that nobody cares about this exact brand of computers. So I have started on the work on a book. If you think that's interesting, then go watch that video. It's only 34 minutes. And I think it was fun talk to give. Then I tried to purchase a thermal camera. I paid 1,500 Danish crowns, which is about, you have to divide by six for dollars, six or seven. So Sean says I'm better with keeping up with the chat than Star Trek. Well, it doesn't take that much. Well, watching Star Trek and talking about Star Trek trivia, I can do that, but playing it on a 50-year-old computer or a replica of one, I apparently suck at that. Anyway, this Basetek TAB100 was a thermal camera. I paid 1,500 Danish crowns for it, and I didn't like it. So I had to make a review about it. I actually have another thermal camera right over. I borrowed this one from a friend who says that this is I borrowed this one from a friend, and I want to see if I can use it to repair broken motherboards with. I'm comparing it with a FLIR module for my old Android phone. I haven't done that video yet, but it will probably show up sometime in August. So I did some benchmarks on an old Pentium 4 because I think it was fun. That's basically just that is just the if you remember the old 3D Mark 2001 benchmark. I recorded it on a an old Pentium 4 with a Matrox G400 card that looks terrible, and then the next day, or a couple of days later, I did the same thing on my Neo. That was actually pretty nice that I hit the same spot there. That was not planned. I just got that idea right now. Anyway, I don't know how well it looks on the stream, but it's way better on my screen at least. Anyway, those videos were kind of easy, but I just felt like I want to have you guys keep up with what I'm doing around the studio as well, because I think it's I think it's interesting when I watch YouTubers who does well, a good example is Frog Leap Studios, which is a guy from Norway, I think, who makes awesome covers of existing songs, and he makes videos about them, and he's really, really, really cool. Go check him out if you Frog Leap Studios in the YouTube search bar should do it. Anyway, he also has a series of videos where he talks about how he decorated his studio and how he sold his house and things like that, and I think that is that's a nice spice for the video, which makes me feel I know the guy a little bit better. I want to try to do the same, but I also have to try not to make it. I want to keep the ratio between retro stuff and behind the scenes stuff fairly acceptable. Slash me waves back at Jake Opsen. I still can't pronounce that abbreviation. Yeah. Anyway, if I remember it, I will drop a link to Leo down below. But he's super, like a million or maybe more subscribers, so you probably know him already. Then I made a video about the Pigolin from Regnecentralen, which is a Danish-built computer running CPM. And go watch the video. I promised you a video. No, I'm going to save that for later. Anyway, this is just a Danish-built CPM computer built on Intel 8186 and not Z80, which is probably what everybody else in the CPM world uses. Not much to say. I just wanted to raise the retro to behind the scenes ratio for this month, so I had to include this. Blackthorn just posted the link for I think that's Frog Leap Studios in the chat. But I'm not sure if the chat will be saved together with this video. It probably won't. That's why I try to read everything you guys write, so that it will be saved for future viewers. Yes. Let me just get back to my schedule. Yeah, so that was the videos of this month. I have made a spreadsheet because I'm a geek and I like numbers. Maybe I can zoom this a bit. I don't know. Not that much. Like this. So my goal is that I want to release at least 2 videos each month. And I want that goal to spend through the entire lifetime of this channel. So, last year, I made 23 videos, which is just under. But I decided to count the one video I made in 2018, the 25th of December. I want to count them together. So, I have decided that I made it for 2009. And in 2020, I want to go over that. And I also don't want to include these streams as because that's too easy. So in practice, from June and onwards, from May and onwards, I need 3 videos a month to reach my goal. And as you see now, I made quite a lot of videos in July. So if I just keep doing 3 videos each month now, I will reach my goal. And I am already at 1 for August now, because this is the first. Speaking of numbers, I also just reached, first of all, the 10 videos in July was crazy. I spent way too much time, so I'm not gonna keep up that pace. However, it paid off because I actually reached 1,600 followers on Instagram and 700 on YouTube. And that's more than 1,000 new followers on Instagram and a little bit over 120 new followers on YouTube in a month. So the pace has paid off. Yeah, well, okay, you said the stream don't count. So the way I do that is that instead of not writing in the streams, I just say that the target is 3 streams after the target is 3 videos after May. So in May I'm 1 behind, and in June I'm on track. In August I have made the video that I forgot or I'm missing in May and February and March. And Sean, what's your name? Yeah, Sean says he's just giving me a hard time. You should give me a hard time. Goals are meant to be strived for. So if I try to chicken around my goals, keep me to it. That's totally acceptable. But I also recognize that I have this spreadsheet, and in my head it makes sense. So maybe I'm not that good enough to explain it because it makes sense to me. So why should I spend time explaining it? Anyway, so I slowly started preparing for my 1,000 follower celebration. I really hope that it will be in 2020. Sorry, I laughed there. That was just Sean who threatens me with a whip to make more videos. Sure, well, I will do that. Oh, and by the way, I totally forgot my hat. So I have a plan for my 1,000 follower celebration, and it's I'm at 721. So since I wrote this script, I apparently got 21 new. Damn, that's fast. Okay. God. In the last status, I talked about what I wanted to do this month. I wanted to make a video about my ZX Spectrum 128 toast rack. I did not do that because I hadn't gotten this yet. That contains the diagnostics module for the ZX Spectrum. I bought it from a guy in the Netherlands called, his name is Ben. The company is called Byte Delight, and he's totally an awesome guy. He has a YouTube channel as well. But he was so stressed out, and he blindly admitted to be behind because during this Corona thing, every nerd in the world decided to break out his old toast rack and his old Spectrum and started playing with it. So he has gotten a huge bunch of orders, and he was way, way, way behind. Fair enough, you know, he's just a one-man band. Him and his wife is driving this shop, so I have no... I'm self-employed myself. Sometimes things just don't happen, and I'm not gonna die because my ZX Spectrum will be broken for yet another month. But there will be a video where I build and review this diagnostics kit, and also another one where I repair my ZX Spectrum toast rack. And together with this, I'm just getting the roasting me on this on the chat for not putting a lid on my Coke. So well, that's nothing on my well, actually there is. Okay, that's a good thing. Anyway, but when I repair the ZX Spectrum, I'm also gonna combine that with the review of this thermal camera, because one of the things I want to do is test if any of the RAM chips get extra hot, because I think I have a periodical error in one of my memory chips on it. That's my idea, but that's a good chance to test out some different analytics methods. And then I also made an Atari. I also promised to test my Atari 2014, which I bought in May. I didn't get around to that, and I'm not gonna get around to it in August. And I'm not gonna get around to some of the things because I have other things I have to do, because I will lose the equipment. I have borrowed this one, and I'll have to give it back soon. And another thing I promised to do was the recapping of my Comet 8. Recapping and repair of Comet 8. I got the kit right here. Problem is that I have borrowed another Comet 8, and I have to give that back as well too. So I need to work on that in this month, because I risk losing my... Well, I have borrowed one which doesn't work either, but if I put together theirs and mine, I got one working. So I have one reference model where I can measure and see if things works, and compare it with the model who does not work. So I need to do that in this month. So I have decided to postpone the Atari test and the Commodore PC tests, which was also something I promised to do, but I didn't make. And then the treasure hunting streams will probably be postponed until sometimes in winter, because it's just more it's just more fitting to sit and work with the boxes of old floppies. So I'm gonna postpone that for the moment. Let me just catch up on the chat. So Sean would like to see more PCV 8256 videos. I'm sure there'll be more Amstrad PCW videos. I actually have a 512 and a 9512 as well, and I also have a PCV 10 or 16. And I have plans to with all of them. I also have a plan about preservation of. I have some floppies that I need to preserve data from. So there are plenty of PCV content in the future. But again, I need to get these projects where I borrowed some stuff. I need to finish them off before I lose access to this stuff. Oh yeah, that could be a fun video as well. I have actually I got two 8256s. Maybe I could upgrade one of them to a 512. That could be an interesting project. Oh yeah, and Blackthorn says that I'm good at not spilling my Coke. Well, but when I do spill my Coke, I often do it at the least desirable moment. Cheers. Whoa! And then I did it. Christ. You guys win this one. Give me just a second. Luckily, I hit myself and the table. Damn. Okay. I got a PPC 512 as well. But let's talk about that project later. Jacobson. Jacobson? How is that pronounced like that? I'm sorry about the trauma. I'm gonna take this one and secure the lid and put it far away from me. Another thing I promised last month was that I would make a video about the Piccoline and the Piccolo. And I made a video about the Piccoline, but I did not get around to the Piccolo. So I will have to do that in August, which is also actually a good thing, because the Piccolo turns 40 this month, and it's a Z80 based machine from Regnecentralen, which boots CPM, or the Danish educational development language called Comal 80. I'm gonna have so much fun making this video, and look forward to that. So we talk about screen colors on the chat, and yeah, this got an amber screen, that's pretty nice. Geeks Geek with social skills tells us he's got a pet 2001 with a green screen. I got one of those too. If you see that pet down there in the corner. Doesn't work though. The screen is collapsed, so I got to fix that as well. Then I also have a plan of making a data transfer video. I have been working on a lot of different ways to transfer data between old computers and to my modern server. And I got a parallel cable, and I got a serial cable, and I got a USB cable for that. And I also been working on some networking stuff, but that's, yeah. And of course, there's floppies. And I'm gonna make maybe a series. I'm not sure about that, but I'm at least gonna make one video about it this month. And then I decide if it will turn into a series. It could probably be a nice series, mainly because it would be something that people would look up, and when you have the need to do it, I would have the video to help them with it. So on the chat, we are still talking about the pet 2001. And I actually don't remember the color of my screen. If you say it's black and white, it probably is. The other pets I have are, as far as I remember, black and white. So now I'm doing... Let's shut that one down. Yeah. So, besides from what I mentioned already, in August I will... make a video about the other thermal camera, which I showed you just before. I have planned a part 2 about the Dallas real-time clock repair. This is... you can't see it. I'm not gonna open it because I want to unbox it on the video. But this is a new... replacement for the Dallas chip, which uses replaceable batteries. I also got a Commodore SX64, which I plan to sell. So I need to make a video where I showcase it before I sell it. I have decided to sell it because I can't use it. Every time I use it, I risk breaking it, hence devaluing its value. And it's not interesting technically, because it can't do anything that my Commodore 128 won't do. So it's actually just a lot of money which I have lying on a shelf. And I'd rather use that on more interesting things. So that's why I decided to put it up for sale in, yeah, maybe already August. I'm not going to sell it for cheap, because I paid a lot for it myself, so I'm gonna try to see if I can get the market price for it. And then I got a video planned about the Lambda 8300. I need to make that in August as well, because I borrowed some gear. I borrowed some cassette tapes. I don't have any software for it myself, but I talked with a guy who have some, and he borrowed that to me. So I got to borrow them, and I need to make a video about that before he has to get them back. So in the chat, it's mentioned that the shipping would be very expensive for my SX64, and you're right, and that's why I plan to demand a pickup for it, because the risk of breaking such a machine is just simply too large. And those are pretty attractive in the European area as well, so... It should be able to find either, hopefully, someone in Denmark, or maybe someone in Sweden or Germany. Both Sweden and Germany is easy accessible by car. So I don't think it's going to be hard to find someone local to pick it up. Talking about, I can see if I can find the picture of it. Actually, I haven't even made a good picture of it yet. The only picture I have is the picture I took on the here. This is on the garden table of the guy which I bought it from. But it's a pretty machine. Anyway, I got to the point now where I need to ask if any of you got some questions for me. And while you think about that, I will try to drink a bit more of my Coke without spilling. Don't laugh. And also, if you feel like it, no spillets. If you feel like it, you should consider joining my Discord server. It's pretty small now. I think only it's 3 or 4 people in there. But do it and make it 8 people, 10 people. And in a short while, it can be the hugest community for retro computing. So, yes. Komal 80 on the Picoline was a thing. Actually, if you see the video I released a couple of days ago, I demonstrated Komal 80 on... I've made an internal loop that says Retro Computing with Mike on it. So, not that nice of a demo, but it's there, and it was widely used. And you, it would have been crazy not to do it, because back then, every kind of software for the educational sector, more or less, was written in Komal 80. So, if you supported that, you could take and port your applications basically without any kind of effort, unless you used graphics or anything other hardware related, which would require some adjustments. So yeah, the Picoline supports Komal 80. So normally I do these videos at 19 European Central Time, and I can't avoid to notice that we are quite a few more people today than we used to. Ah, well, maybe not. Maybe let's see here. We have been 6. We are 5 people right now, and we are 6 people tops. So maybe that's just me. Should I do these streams later than 19? Will that if I try to do them at 22, maybe is that a better time? No, I haven't had it. Oh, so that somebody wrote a question and deleted it again. So I'm not gonna respond to it then. That's probably the reason why he deleted it. So it's from Geeks with Social Skills. He says that it's about 20 minutes to 3 where he is. And I am really impressed that he actually used a 24-hour system. That's rare to see Americans use that. Thank you for that. Okay, the question got back now. So Jacobson asks if I have seen the 8-bit guys Commander X16 project. Yes. That's an awesome project, and I actually sometimes I considered making my own like computer. I'm not considering. I'm planning on doing. I have some other goals besides from the 8-bit guy's goal. I'm not. He's a little bit more. What is it called? Ambitious than me. I would rather build something that you yourself could build from off-the-shelf parts, like, you know, you would get an Arduino and you would get some memory chips and some different components and build it yourself and then have an open source firmware for it and make a small computer that way. But I haven't started that project yet. Regarding electronics, I am actually about to start a series of videos where I used Ben Eder. Another YouTuber has made a kit you could purchase, and with that you could build a 6502 computer on a breadboard. That's a really interesting project, and I want to make some videos where I do some of the exercises. And then the next step from there will be I will need to learn to make PCBs myself. I have some huge series planned for that as well. Next step, or maybe a simultaneous step, will be to make my own Apple One replica computer. I actually purchased a motherboard, of course a replica. So I have plans to build stuff myself, but I'm not good at it, so I need to start slowly. Oh yeah, of course it could be nice to... that would almost be a demand. So Jacobson says that it would be interesting to see if it could interface with other old hardware. I've also thought about that. If you see the IS4000 video on my channel as well, some of the guys from the Danish Data Museum built an SSD drive for an old mainframe machine. That was a BeagleBone, which simulated a drum storage controller and made the BeagleBone simulate the drum storage unit. That was a super nice project, and I have been thinking about doing something, not quite I like it, but something for practice. So I thought about making an Arduino that would simulate an EEPROM, so that when you write software and want to build it and deploy it to an EEPROM, you would actually deploy it to an Arduino. And then you could write your software on a PC and deploy it to an EEPROM, which was already in the machine, which would be an Arduino, of course. And then the Arduino would just keep acting as the old EEPROM right up until the new one was in place, and like do a shift like that, and then maybe trigger a reset. Also, a great question. The other Jacob says that we could do an SSD for the Comet 3400. I'd rather do one for the Comet 8, actually. And that would actually be easier, because that one got a floppy drive, and I think it's quite a lot easier to simulate a floppy drive. Actually, that would just be a GoTek drive. Well, that's maybe too easy. Well, thanks for watching. Join the Discord and check the links and stuff below for to see how you can interrogate and maybe support the channel. See you out there in the dark corners of the interwebs.